Yeah, so hello, good evening guys. So as you know, the topic for today's session is introduction to hash maps in C++. So before starting, I would just like to say that the prerequisites for it is like you should know the basics of C++ commands and all, and further we'll have a look what hash maps are, and we'll practice some questions. And after this session, I hope you would be able to like solve problems based on hash maps easily. Okay, and at any point of time, if you have any doubts, you can directly like speak, because I okay, or type it out. Okay, so let us start. Yeah, so what are hash maps? So like, first of all, is it clearly visible, right? Do I need to zoom in or something? Like presentation and all are visible, right? Okay.
Yes.
Yeah, okay. So basically what hash maps are, hash maps are basic data structures that maps the keys to a particular values. I'll explain like practically how it is, but for now you can know that we can map any keys. Like key can be anything, int, integer type, string type, character, anything. As you know, like in arrays we have keys as integers only, but in hash maps you can have it in like we can have any kind of keys, be it integer type, strings, or etc. Right. So why do we need hash maps? So to have a clear picture of it, we'll see a question, and then we'll see what difficulty we face and why we require hash maps there. Okay. And then we'll see, first of all, we'll understand why we require it, and then we'll see how to implement it or how do we use it. Right. So say the question is, you are given a string and you need to find the highest occurring character in it. Okay, so what I mean by that is, so say you are given string str, something like this, some string would be given to you. Okay, and say it is A A B B C C C. So the highest occurring character here is C. Okay, so what one approach could be, so what one of the approach could be, like you can or say or you have integers in it, okay, or anything you can have, it's a string, right? You can, the first approach could be, you could first of all sort it, okay, you can sort it, and then you will iterate over the whole loop. Okay, so if like it is W X A B C, or it is 1 4 3 2 1 1, so it would convert into, right, 1 1 2 3 4. Okay, and then if you will iterate over the loop, right, from starting till the end, and then you can eventually find out like the number of character, how many times that particular character has occurred in the string. So if you look the time complexity of it, so we know that the like sorting would take say like n log n time, okay, right? And iterating over the whole loop would take O of n time, right? Where n is the length of the string. Okay, so overall our time complexity is this one. Overall our time complexity is n log n. Okay, but if we want to like decrease our time complexity further, say to O of n, which is the optimal case. Okay, so one case could be we can make an array. Okay, we can make an array of say size 256, because we know that the characters are like are basically 256 in number, or say if not 256, they are in finite number. Okay, so for a finite number, we can make an array and initialize it with zero. Okay, and then if we'll iterate over the loop and say it is 1, 2, 3, so if one occurs, what I'll do is for array of 1, I'll just simply plus, I'll just increase the number of occurrence, like the value which denotes the number of times it has occurred in that particular string, right? So this could be done, or in case of like string could be anything, right? A, B, C, D, A, characters, anything. So for that, basically we'll just take ASCII value. Okay, for every ASCII value, because ASCII value will return us an integer, right? And in arrays, these keys, this one, this is called key, and this the particular value is the value, right? For each value, for each key, we have a value. So in arrays, it is like must that the key is always an integer. We know that. So if we'll utilize the ASCII value of each and every character or any particular string, we can directly sort it out, this question, and this could be done in O of n. But the space complexity is also high depending on the characters. Okay, but this we know, this is the particular solution, and I wanted to show you the use of hash maps. Okay, so say the next is, now what if we need to find the highest occurring word? This time we are not finding out the highest occurring character. Instead, we need to find out the highest occurring word, and that too in the optimal time complexity of O of n, where n is the length of the string. Okay, so here comes the role of hash maps. What I am saying is, if I have A, B, C, D, E, F, A, B, C, this is my particular string which I pass, okay, which the user passes. So my output should be ABC, because it has occurred, this word has occurred two times. Okay, so if now you look at why can't we use the array thing again, right? Because in previous case there were characters are finite in number, you agree, right? Whereas words can be infinite, not meaningful words. Word can be anything like A, B, C, X, A, B, C, anything. So these possibilities are infinite. So we cannot create a array with the size of infinite, and then simply based on the ASCII value we'll increase, or we cannot store using arrays. So here comes hash maps in role. Okay, why we require hash maps? So for this particular question, what we want basically is, we'll have some hash map, say by the name of umap. Say umap is an array, think of it as an array, but instead this time what we want is, we want to store for ABC equals 1 or any particular value for this key, whereas in arrays this key cannot be a character or string, this can only be integer. So this is not possible in arrays, that's why we require hash maps. Okay, so for any particular string, this can be anything. Okay, so for any particular string we will increment it this way. So if we are able to do it in this way, like the previous approach, we would again be able to do it in the time complexity of O of n, right? Because we'll again say whatever word comes, whatever input user gives us, we'll check out the word and we'll directly do plus plus. Say for this, I'll increase the number of occurrences in it. And at last, I'll iterate over the whole hash map, say umap, and find the max value, or I can update it simultaneously. Okay, so this is the way. So right now we get the picture why we are using hash maps and what it does is. Now how to, we'll see. And by this we are clear what different functions we require from the hash maps. Okay, so first one is insert, right? Like in arrays, we can directly say for my array of 1, I need to store the value of say a or anything 2, 3, etc. So similarly, we require insert function also in hash maps, and similarly we require get value because for each, this is right, you know, this is key again and this is value. So for each key I need to access the value also, right? And at the same time, if I do not want any particular element in the array, same as in array, so I want to also delete that particular key in hash maps. So these are very basic, like we need to insert it, get the value and delete it, same. So these three functions also we require from the hash maps. Now what are the different ways in which we can implement hash maps? So basically in C++ you can directly use the inbuilt standard template library of unordered map for the hash maps or maps directly, but how they are implemented, how the hash maps actually are implemented, if you want to see behind the screen how it is actually implemented, so they are in three ways. I've explained you what we need to do, what hash map does, and if I say to you now write a program, in C++, you know, right, you can make your own data structures, anything, you can make your own functions, etc., like that. So if I want to say, like whatever I have discussed with you till now, I want to say make a program for that. So different approaches could be, you can do that using linked list, BST, like binary search trees, and the hash tables. So how each of this implementation would be, we'll have a quick look over it. So if I say I need to do whatever I have discussed till now using the linked list. So how you can do it is, you know that, right? In linked list, I'll store two things now. Because in linked list, right? So in linked list, I'll store two things in it. One is the key and one is the value, right? In linked list, we can do that. Okay, I'll store simultaneously two things in it, in each of the box of the linked list. Say one is key and another is the value. And so if we discuss about, and then we can link it, right? Like to the next one, to the next, whatever values we require for a particular key. So this goes on. We can iterate over the whole elements whichever we want to store in it. Okay, so this goes on. So if we discuss about all of the like time complexity of all of the functions, say we discussed about inserting. So in linked list, you know, if I want to insert anything, like I'll insert at the start. Okay, so you might say that the time complexity is O(1). So that's not the case. I'll say that the time complexity is O(n), not O(1). If I want, why I am saying the time complexity is O(n) is because first of all, you need to check whether that particular value already exists or not. Okay, you are understanding, right? If I am having For ABC, I have already stored one value of 1, and this goes on for DEF, say value is 2. And again, if I say I need to insert value as 1 for ABC, so I cannot directly insert it at the beginning or the end, like in this way. If I want to insert directly at the beginning, I cannot do in that way. Why? Because I need to check that whether the ABC already exists or not. So as we can see, ABC already exists. So I will be updating over here, taking the same scenario which we discussed in the earlier question, like the number of occurrences of the word in the given string. So I need to update over here. So I will make this 1 to 2. So for this purpose, I need to iterate over the whole linked list, and then only I'll get to know that whether that particular key exists or not. If not, then I'll insert it at the beginning. Okay. So that's why for insert also, the time complexity is for insert also the time complexity is O of n. Okay. And we had another is get value. For getting any value for a particular key, I again need to iterate over the whole linked list, right? And so again it's O of n. Then for deleting a particular value, again I need to iterate over the whole linked list, and then I would be able to delete it, right? So for all these functions, we have the time complexity of O of n. Now looking at the another way of implementing it, say binary search trees. Okay, I won't be going deep in it, but say this is, you know, right, binary search trees are there. So in this way, like say one binary search tree is there, and we'll insert, like we can arrange these values, say in the case of words, we can arrange, say, you will ask how I will arrange in a form of binary tree, because those are words, right? So for that, what we can do is we can say, if I want to discuss like why ABC is less than DEF, if I say that, so this is one kind of comparator. Say lexicographically we can compare that whether this string is smaller or greater, and then in this way we can implement it over binary search trees. What lexicographically basically means it, since A is smaller than the first character, say D, that's why this string is lexicographically smaller than DEF. Okay, so we know that again in binary search trees, BSTs, if you want to find something or we need to insert any value, for all of these functions, we already know that in BSTs, the time complexity is log of n. So you see, we are moving at a better time complexity for O of n to O of log n. And now, what I want is, like you remember from where we began? We began from the arrays. And then we want an alternative for arrays, which is Hashmaps. In Hashmaps, we can store, we can have keys as anything. It is not necessary to be an integer only. Okay, so I want my Hashmap to be exactly like arrays. So in arrays, you know that, right? All of this can be done. All of these functions, like say I want what's there in like my array's zeroth index, I can directly type array of 0 and it will give me the value, right? So all of these functions in array is done in O of 1 time complexity, right? And I want to achieve that. For that, what Hashmaps basically are implemented in are using hash tables. I'll quickly tell what hash tables are, and then we'll move on the implementation part. This is like, because you need to know how the things are going on behind the screen, okay? You cannot just start directly using standard template libraries, okay? So, one second, right. So we are discussing about hash tables, and the time complexity is O of 1. So what hash this hash table does is, say it will have it will store there is a function, like there is a hash function, and then it does a compression over it. Okay, so basically these two things are done in this hash tables. So I have a particular hash function which gives me a unique integer. It returns me a unique integer for whatever key I give to the hash function. See, I'm giving ABC to my hash function. Say it will, according to my hash function, it gives me a value of 1, 2, 3, 4, 7, any kind of value like this. Okay. So, what it basically does is, it returns me an integer based on the hash function. So, now we have got the integer, right? So, we can implement it in a fashion of arrays, because we know that in arrays, this can be any. In arrays, key can be integer. So if I'll say 1, 2, 3, 4, 7 or whatever that integer was, and then I'll update over here. So you see, it behaves like an array in somewhat manner. Okay, but say why we require compression is, say you have a very big number, right? Your hash function returns a very big number. So you can, and you know that I want to sum it up all in range of 0 to 20. So what you can do is, you can again map this 1, 2, 3, 4, say to 1, right? To 1. So in this way, right? So you can mark your 1, 2, 3, 4, 7 to 1, or say any other number comes, say 2, 3, 4, and you can map it to 2, and in this way it goes on. Okay, so supposingly, like, collision is not occurring. What I mean by collision is, we are not getting two same values for any particular word. Okay, so this was just a gist of it. Now we'll implement, we'll see what inbuilt hash maps are, and how we can use it in C++. So in inbuilt we have two things, map and unordered map. So as you can understand by the name, one is unordered map and another is map. So you can say, like, the map stored its values, like, it has in a sequential manner. There is a particular sequence maintained to it. If I'll insert first 1, then 2, then 3, it would stay as it is in it, or say 4, 2, 3, it will stay as it is while I'll be iterating over the map. But whereas in unordered map, as the name suggests, it is unordered. Even though if I enter 2 first, then 3, and then 1, but if I'll access this unordered map, so this can give me, at the beginning of the unordered map, it can give me 1, and then it can give me 2, and then it can give me 3. Like, in random fashion or any other fashion, it can return me the values. Okay, so maps are implemented using BSTs, that's why its time complexity is log of n, whereas unordered maps are implemented using hash table, as we discussed, and that's why its time complexity is O of n. So moving forward, so now let us see all the functions which we discussed right now, right? This one we discussed till now, three functions: insert, finding or accessing the values, and then deleting it or say erasing it. So before going on to that, do you guys have any queries or any doubts till now? Or anything like this was just a basic. Now we'll be starting with actual hash maps and coding into it. Okay, so I don't see like there are any doubts. Okay, so we'll continue. Okay, so first of all, if we want to include, we will have to include a library of say, okay, unordered map, and right, or you can directly use if you guys know, you can directly use hash include bits slash stdc++.h. So it includes all the libraries by itself, common libraries, IOH tree, unordered map, vector, or all of these kind of things. Or you can directly use this library instead of these two. Okay. So first of all, how to declare an unordered map. So you declare unordered map by typing unordered map, and say I'm taking the string case only. So string, and for particular string, this string is my key and this is my value. So whatever kind of key I want to store, I'll define it here. I'll write it over here, and whatever value for a particular key is there, I'll write it over here. Okay, for a string I need to store an integer, and say I need to name my unordered map as umap. Okay, so since we are using string also over here, so we need to include the string library too, right? Okay, I got one doubt, one second. Yeah, so you are asking which one is better, unordered map or simply map, if we consider like time complexity and space complexity. Okay, so definitely unordered map is better than simple map based on these two things, but you need to decide where you want to use what. Okay, where can you use unordered map and where can you use simply map? So it's simple, right? I explained you, right? For unordered map, you don't have a particular sequence. Okay, so in questions, if you don't require, right? So in questions, if you don't require sequence is not important to you, so you can directly use unordered maps. And if sequence is important to you, you need to use maps. So I hope it answers your doubt, and we'll quickly implement it. Okay. So I need to include string also. Okay, from next time I won't be using that. I'll directly use bits/stdc++.h library. And first of all, I explained you how to for the insert function. So you can insert in two ways. Okay, since you know that it's a pair, right? We are storing a pair. For a string, we are having a particular integer, and then we are storing it in the umap. Okay, so again we have to define a pair in C++. We can use, for a string I am storing an int value, right? And let me name it as p, and say the word is, sorry, it's a string, say the string is apple, and for apple I need to store one. So I've made my pair, and then I need to insert it in my unordered map. So I'll type it as umap.insert. So this is the function. This is one of the way to insert it. Okay. So this is one of the way, or you can directly do it as say my map name is umap, right? So umap, like in arrays, for say banana, I'm storing the value as 2. So you see, it's pretty much similar like arrays. Okay, so for banana, I'm storing a value of 2. So this is how you insert it. Now, if you look at as finding or accessing the values. Okay, so for that, what directly as in as we used to do in arrays, you can directly say that umap of apple, and you can directly access the values. Okay, so this is the way, and in this way you can directly say. Another thing is if you use, there is an add function also, umap, sorry, if I do cout umap dot at mango. Okay, so this line, this particular line, this is a function in unordered maps, at, that means it will return you the value present at the mango. Okay, mango is a string, for a particular string, this is my like say key, it will give me the value for this key. Okay, so you can use at, but since you need to be very careful with this function. Why? Because I'll comment it out also. Why? Because this since mango is not, we have not inserted mango yet, so it will give me an error saying it will give me an error. Okay, because mango is not there and I'm finding the value present at mango, so it will return me an error. So you need to be very careful using it, because sometimes value can be there and cannot be there. So in okay, so better to use this in this way, umap and accessing it directly. So if you okay, and for finding out the size size of your unordered map, you can do as umap dot size. Okay, so this is the way in which you can find out the size of your unordered maps. And okay, so now let me check the presence. Sometimes, like right here we got stuck because sorry, not here. Here, mango is not present in the unordered map. So here we got stuck because we don't know whether it's there or not inside our unordered map. So if we not, if we need to, sorry, yeah, if we need to check the presence. Okay, so for that, what we can do is, we have a function called if, we'll check it in this way. Okay, if umap dot count, we are finding out the like number of times it has occurred. So again, a particular key can occur only one time. Okay, so if that count is greater than 0, that means it occurs, right? So we can say that cout that mango is present. Okay, so in this way we can do it, right? And at last, if you want to erase it, okay, for erasing you can directly do as umap dot erase and whatever value you want to erase, say mango. So you can directly erase in this fashion. Okay, so I hope it's clear. All of these functions are pretty easy. Again, we'll have a look over it. If you need to insert, you can either make a pair and then insert it in this fashion, or you can directly do it as is, as we do in array. Okay, and then to exit it, again like in arrays, and to declare it, we declare it using this unordered map and type of key and type of value. Okay, and then for size we use dot size, and for checking the presence we directly say that dot count. So I hope it's clear. Okay, let's move on. So this is what mentioned over here. Okay, and now let's quickly solve a problem. We are now packed up with tools, some basic tools of unordered maps, and we can now solve the problems which earlier we won't be able to solve in the optimal time complexity, but since we now know the hash maps, we can definitely do it in the optimal, in an optimal fashion. So the question is, you are given an array of integers. Okay, one second. So you are given an array of integers and you need to remove all the duplicate elements and return them in the same order as they appear originally in the array. Okay, so what I mean by that is, you are given an array which store values like 1, 2, 3, 7, 5, 7, 1, 3. So this is, say, this is the array given to us, and we need to remove the duplicate elements. Okay, so we need to remove the duplicate elements. So duplicate elements are this 7 and this 1 and this 3. Okay, and we need to print out the elements as they appear in the same order. So I need to print out 1, 2, 3, 7, 5. Okay, so in the this would be our resultant, okay, result or the output. So we need to do that in the optimal time complexity, which would be O of n, where n is the length of the array. Now, why can't we use arrays for the above question, right? We can again declare an array, and for say array of, I'll iterate over the loop, and for the array of 1, I'll do the plus plus. Like I'll increase the times number of occurrences are there, right? And in this manner, I can directly remove out the duplicates. But what the issue over here is, there are two issues. First of all, integers can be very long, right? Like 10 to the 15, or say 10 to the power 9, or say 10 to the power 10. So you cannot have the array of that much size. So for that particular reason, one reason, array is not feasible. The second particular reason is, say if you have negative integers also included in it. So you cannot have a negative key value in arrays, right? What I am saying is, if I have minus 1 also in this array, I cannot say that array of minus 1 and then plus plus. So these are the two issues which we face, which we will face using the arrays. So if we look, if we code how this would work, one second. So we'll quickly code how this would work. Okay, let's see question one. Okay, so so what we have is, say I have an int array, okay, one second, yeah, with the values of say 1, 2, 3, 3, say 2, 1, 4, 3, let us include more, okay, 6, 5, 5, so I think that's enough, okay, and what I, okay, and I'll, so I'll make a function, say, int, solve. We'll quickly do this question. Okay. One second. I need to return the array, right? So say I'll define vector init. Okay. So I hope you guys know vector. Vector is simply again similar to arrays, because I need to return the array. So I'll say vector of solve, and that I'll pass it two things, which would be, one would be my array. Say my array name is A, and another thing would be size of the array. Since I need to return the vector, I'll say vector of int, and I want this as my answer. And what I said was, we'll iterate over the loop. Say int I equals 0, say like I less than the size, whichever is passed to us, and I plus plus. And we'll check the presence. First of all, we'll check the presence, if it's present or not. Okay, so I'll say we'll make one second another map also, so that we can update for particular int. I'll update a boolean value for presence. Okay, so what I'm doing here is I'm making unordered map, and for each value, say one, I'll store whether it's present or not. So if it would be present, I'll say true. If it won't be present, then it would be false. Okay. So that's why I'm declaring an unordered map with the key of integer and value of bool. For the presence, with the name of say presence or present. Okay. Now I'll check if it's already present, right? Because before updating, we need to check if it's already present or not. So if I'll check present, I already told you to check, we can use count. Okay. So for count of A of I for that particular value, if it's greater than 0, then I'll say that continue, since it's already present. So I don't want it to store in my answer vector. Okay, so I'll continue. I'll go to the next iteration of for the value of I. And if it's not present, I'll say mark it as true. Now it's present. Okay, so it would be true, and I need to store this value also, okay, because I need to return. So to store in vectors, we use pushback, if you don't know. So I'll push back A of I, and that's it, I guess. And then I'll return the answer. Okay, so we have passed, and so I'll pass my this array, and size is, how much is size? 11. Okay, and I need to print it out. Okay, so for to print all the values, I'll say cout answer, whatever value is stored over there. So in this fashion, in this manner, we can simply do it. Okay, I'll again show you what we have done is, so this is our array, and we had made an vector of say name by answer, and this is our function which will help us to solve. And we are just iterating over the loop, and we are checking if it's already present. If it's present, we'll continue. If it's not present, we'll mark it as true, and we'll store it in our vector, and then we'll print our vector. So So it's pretty simple, right? So any doubts in that, so you can ask. Till then I'll execute it and show it to you. If you have guys have any doubts. So yeah, so no errors, right? So you can see that it appears in the same fashion. One would come and then two, you can see it over here, right? One, two, three, and three was repeated, two was repeated, so it gave me then 6, 5. So this is our resultant. So our codes work perfectly. Okay, so now we look ahead. Okay, so we have the similar questions which you can try it out. I'll like paste these links and you can have a look. Okay, and you can have a look of it afterwards, or I'll also share it in the group also. Let me just quickly share these two ones. Okay, so I'll explain what it is. Maximum repeating number. So you need to just find out the maximum, the number which has occurred the most times. And another question is you need to find out the count pairs with the given sum. Say one of the alternative, like the question which appears over net is you need to find the pairs with the sum of 0, or they can generalize it. You need to find the all pairs which gives us the sum of k, any particular value, any particular integer. So it's very easy. These two questions are very easy, and if you'll check these two questions out, they are rated as medium or something, but if you know, it's very easy to solve, right? Okay, so accuracy is this, don't look over it, it's pretty easy. You can solve it after the session. Now one thing which is left is iterators. Iterator is very important, right? Because if in arrays we had a particular index value, right, for all of the for all of the elements in it. But in the case of unordered map, we don't have a particular sequence also, and we are not using any addresses, like it would be linked like in the linked list. So how we would iterate over the whole loop? This is the question, right? In questions, we would be requiring to iterate over the whole loop. Okay, so for that, how we'll implement it, iterators. So say you can see it over here. A sample code is given. Say you have again defining the. You are defining. So you are defining over here the unordered map and by the name of umap, and then you are storing say 5 values. For apple you are storing 1, for mango you are storing 2, banana 3, guava 4, orange 5. So these are the 5 elements which you have stored in the unordered map by the name of umap. Okay, and then how you utilize iterators, and what iterators are is basically iterators is a pointer, and it stores the say address of it. And if you make the use of the function as plus plus, there is a function of iterator. So using that, you can directly jump over the next whatever next value or key is there in anything. Say in vectors also we use iterators, okay? So or in unordered maps also, so whatever next value is there, it will point to that. And we can, if it would point to us, so by dereferring it, we can directly access our values. So what I meant by that is, I told you that it stores the address. So if I'll say you, I'll store the address of the beginning of my unordered map and iterate it till the end address of my unordered map. Okay, So you can do it in the similar fashion. You need to define it is an unordered map of string and integer type. Then this is the like command for it, :: iterator it, name it, this it you can define it as any name of your iterator. And then we are storing the beginning address of our unordered map, say by using umap.begin, and we'll iterate it till our it is not equal to umap.end, which is the it doesn't point us till the end address of our unordered map. So we'll iterate till that. And now we for printing out the key, this is this in this way you can print out the key. I already told you that it's a pointer. So in C++ for accessing pointers, you can use this it, then this arrow, then first. It first will give us the key because it's the first value, first thing in our unordered maps. And for accessing the value, you will use it arrow second. Or you can use, I told you this is the way of dereferencing. Or if you guys don't understand it, another way you can do it is I told you to dereference it. So you can use star it, okay, dot first. So in this way also you can access. Or okay, so some of you might know by this. So these are the two ways you can access, okay, dereferencing it and then accessing the value, right? And in this fashion you can print out the values or access the keys and values stored in the in our unordered maps. Okay, so now the more practice problems which you can look over, and these are the famous ones. And these are like, if you'll think for a minute or two or 5 minutes max, you would be able to find out the solution or way to solve these questions very easily. So I definitely I would suggest you to solve these questions after this session, or take a break after this and solve this question. You like, since it's fresh in your memory, so you can you would be easily able to solve these questions. Okay, so I'll paste it over chat. Okay, and so before right, we can, I guess we can I'll just discuss the approach of one problem, and then we can end this session, right? So I told you this is the question. I'll discuss the easier approach for this, like not the exact approach, because you can solve it by your own. I'll just for this question, it's given that we need to count the pairs with the given sum. So I can tell you the approach. Sometimes you can find the question directly as in an easier fashion, that you need to find the pairs with the given sum which results to the sum of 0. So for that, what you can do is in the similar way, you just need to replace 0 with k, whatever k value is given to you. Okay, so I'll just to give you make it more familiar to you, I'll explain quickly, just tell you the approach of it. So how you can do is, you can iterate over the what is given to us, array. Okay, so we'll iterate over the array, and then using the umap, whatever value is there, say in array of I, okay, I'll increase, for the number of times it has occurred, I'll do this plus plus. So it will increase, like it would update my value in it. So I'll do it for the all the elements in it. Okay, now here again, remember you need to make the use of that count function, because you need to check, don't forget this count function, you need to check whether it already exists or not. So this would be useful when you will implement it. If you are new to this topic, you would see that. Okay, and after doing this, okay, I'll again iterate over the, now I'll iterate over the umap, I'll iterate over the unordered map, and now for each value, say my 2 occurs 4 times and say my minus 2 occurs 3 times. Okay, so if I iterate over the umap and I got the key as 2, and I'll access the value of 2, which would be 4, and I'll check if minus 2 occurs or not. Okay, using the find or count function, you can use the count function if it minus 2 exists or not in my umap. If it exists, then I'll access my value for minus 2, which would be 3. And these functions are all done in O of 1 time complexity, you see. And iterating over the loop takes O of n. Okay, and to find out the pairs, it would be 4 times 3. So for this particular scenario, I can have 12 pairs. And in this way, I'll go on and I'll update my answer. I'll do, right, answer plus equals and whatever value I got, say 12, I'll update it. And then I'll just simply return my answer. So in the same fashion, you can do it for the k, whatever k is given to you. And once you have done with it, there is another problem. I have not mentioned it, if you want to try, you can try it out. It's a very good question. For some problem, here you are checking for pairs. Pair means you are checking for two things, two sum, say it as two sum. Now here you are doing four sum. So in four sum, one of the approaches, you can use the approach of two sum twice. This won't be clear to you, but I'm just giving you a hint. If you can search over internet four sum problem, and it will appear on the top, and then you can read this statement and then think of it. Think of doing this question in the fashion you did two sum problem, this count pair one, right? So for hash, and another approach for two sum is using two pointers, but we are discussing about hash maps. So you can also implement four sum problem with hash maps. It's a good problem, and it's comes under medium difficulty, but once you get the hang of it, it's pretty easy. So we can conclude this session, and before that, one second. Yeah. So if you guys have any doubts, and I just want to say, hash maps are they are really awesome and useful in so many scenarios, and it improves the time complexity drastically. And after this session, have a look over these questions, and I'm pretty sure you would be able to solve all of these questions. They are pretty easy. Okay, so any doubts? If you have any doubts, you can type it over chat or ask. And till then, I'll take the attendance. Okay, I'll download, one second.